Good afternoon, everybody. We're very, very glad to have Professor Alex Alvarez back with us. Professor Alvarez presented to the lecture series last year, and he was so well received that we received a voluntary donation to support his coming back this year. And I think you'll understand why as he gives his lecture. Professor Alvarez comes to us from Northern Arizona University in Flagstaff, where he's a professor in the criminology and criminal justice department. In short, Dr. Alvarez's extensive research focuses on comparative violence, from schoolyard bullies to Nazi perpetrators, and they have a great deal in common, as I'm sure you'll discover. He is co-editor of a new journal entitled Genocide Studies and Prevention, and he has published many books, including Violence, the Enduring Problem, Murder American Style, and Governments, Citizens, and Genocide. His most recent book is Genocidal Crimes. Professor Alvarez is with us today to discuss an intriguing topic that was new to our lecture series last year and is of abiding importance and obvious importance to the good citizens of California: climate change, border wars, and the genocide impulse. So please welcome Professor Alex Alvarez.
Thank you. Well, good evening, everyone, or good afternoon. How's everyone doing? Hanging in there, I understand this is midterms. Is that right? All right. Well, I wish you all luck, not that you need it. Before I begin today, I would like to first off say how pleased I am to be back here again this year. I really enjoyed my visit last year and the interactions I had with the audience. I also would like to acknowledge with gratitude the people at the center for helping make this possible and for sponsoring this exceptional speaker series. I'm not sure if you know this, but if you look at the upcoming list of speakers, these are some world-class scholars, people who are very eminent in their fields, and it's quite the opportunity you have to participate in lectures and conversation with some of these folks. I also would like to acknowledge Lillian and Dennis Judd for underwriting my visit and allowing me to be part of this exceptional series of events. In many ways, it's actually quite appropriate for me to be here and to talk about the issue of climate change and conflict. In many ways, California, you are on the front lines of climate change. You are in the middle of a multi-year drought that has dramatically impacted your lives here, whether or not you realize it. In California, it seems that hardly a week goes by I'm not hearing news from California, whether it's in terms of the drought, in terms of flooding, lack of snowpack. On the drive over here this morning from Sacramento, I realized it's actually very green here, but I understand your February was very dry, and that if you look at the overall statistics, California is still somewhat below average in terms of water. It's also, I think, just a couple of weeks now that the largest single methane leak in U.S. history was capped outside of Los Angeles, after something like 100,000 tons of methane were leaked into the atmosphere. Pretty significant, especially when you realize that methane is something like 25 times more powerful than CO2 in terms of its impact as a greenhouse gas. So here in California, these issues are not just hypothetical, they're very real. And so I hope some of the things I'm going to be talking with you tonight will resonate, will make some sense to you. In many ways, what this presentation reflects is my own thinking and progression as I explore some of these issues myself. I'm not a climate change scientist. I'm someone for about 25 years or so, I've been studying violence. As Diane had mentioned, some of the different forms of violence, seeing where we find common patterns and precursors to violence. But having a little bit of awareness of things going on around me, I live in Arizona where things like drought and wildfires and these kind of things are ever-present realities. The awareness of climate change and its impact and its ongoing impact that seems to be manifesting every year more clearly at some point led me to begin looking at this issue of violence, especially genocidal violence, and how the coming stresses and strains may well increase the risk for certain kinds of communal organized violence. And so in some ways, that's kind of the spirit in which I am approaching this presentation tonight. The historian Timothy Snyder just came out with a book this past year called Black Earth, The Holocaust as History and Warning. And this is a follow-up to his first book, Bloodlands, which was very well received. This one has received a little more criticism. In fact, Omer Bartov, a very distinguished historian, just wrote a fairly critical review of this. But Snyder wrote a couple of lines in that book that I think are very important. And he argues that understanding the Holocaust is our chance, perhaps our last chance, to preserve humanity. And he argues that the past provides some very powerful lessons in terms of how human communities act and react to certain kinds of stresses and strains. And in many ways, I would echo that. It mirrors some of my own thinking in regards to his ideas. We don't know necessarily how societies will react to climate change. But we do know how conflicts start. We do know how certain kinds of processes that lead to organized violence, that lead to persecution, how those operate. We know a lot more today about genocide than we did even just 10 or 20 years ago. And what I would suggest is if we look at the projected impacts of climate change, there are some very real risks that we need to be very careful about, not just here in the United States, but globally as well. But before we begin talking about some of those, before we talk about the future, I first want to talk about the past. Because I think the past, in some ways, can illustrate certain fundamental principles that are at play here. And the place I want to start with is on a road trip I took not that long ago with my son to a place in southwestern Colorado called Mesa Verde. Has anyone here ever been there? Okay, pretty amazing place. For my son, it was a real eye-opening kind of experience. If you're in southwestern Colorado, you're oftentimes in between mountain ranges, and there's this one big high plateau, and if you drive up to it, you start approaching this kind of landscape. And as you drive along, or as you walk along up on this high plateau, you begin seeing in these alcoves old ruins. And your first thought might be, how the heck did anyone ever get in there? And how did they live there? Because as you can see from something like this, it is actually pretty inaccessible. Oh. All right. Now, there are a number of famous ruins there that are often referred to as cliff castles. In fact, the first non-native to discover them was a rancher by the name of Wetherill. And he and his brother-in-law in the 1880s were looking for some lost cattle in the middle of December, having to walk their horses sometime because they were scared of riding off of the edge of one of these escarpments. And they saw across the way what they referred to as these cliff castles. And they're very impressive structures situated in the overhangs, oftentimes fairly high up. And you can see that even after all these years, these are actually pretty impressive ruins. Very well engineered, very well protected. Here you see the entrance to a kiva, a sacred ceremonial site. But they're high up. They're not easy to get to. Even today, if you go to visit these, and it's a national monument, you need to get tickets, and then you're escorted with a ranger who gives you a nice little tour. You have to do a fair amount of scrambling I think we're going to have to go low tech here. All right. To get around, there are places you have to crawl up little ladders and out little holes. There are ladders. I don't know about you, but this kind of is a little bit scary to be on the side of a cliff and crawl up one of these ladders. In places you actually go up. In places you actually go up old footholds and handholds that are actually carved into the rock, although nowadays you have a nice rail to help protect you. But can you imagine doing it years and years ago, maybe holding a child in an arm or some food or water as you're trying to negotiate this? And when you go to a place like this and you explore these ruins, it's very natural to ask a few questions. Who are these people? And why the heck did they build in such a very difficult location? It turns out they only lived in those ruins, or they weren't ruins back then, but they only lived in those locations for around 70 years or so. And actually, we now know more about those people than we used to. There's still much we don't know. But as their history has been uncovered, it actually tells us a lot about climate change and a lot about conflict. And so to explore this, we have to understand a little bit about the Four Corners region, which is where we find Mesa Verde. So Mesa Verde is right in this area right around here. But this whole region here is known as the Four Corners region. It's a hard land. It's cut by tremendous washes and canyons. There is not a lot of vegetation. You can see this is, for those of you who aren't familiar with it, Monument Valley. Hard, arid landscape. In other places, there is vegetation, but it's pretty sparse. Not an easy place to live, certainly. And what we know is that for many generations, the Paleo-Indians who lived here lived in very small family bands, constantly on the move, because the lands could not support large populations and not populations in one place for an extended period of time. So you have small family bands that are constantly on the move in the search of food, very low population density. But then a couple of things happened that changed it. One, the American Southwest, including the Four Corners there, entered a period of more regular precipitation. Now keep in mind, in the Southwest, it is semi-arid or outright arid. There's not a lot of rain. So even in this area, or even during this time period, you had rains were more regular, but it's still pretty sporadic. And it's the kind of landscape where you would have a nice rain in one area, 2 miles away, bone dry. But it was more rain on average than it had been receiving previously. And at the same time, you had the introduction of maize and then beans. Agriculture shows up. And since it coincides with more regular precip, agriculture made possible population growth, more settlement. Even in its very primitive form, agriculture can sustain far more people, can provide nutrition for far more people than foraging can. So the populations grew. And over time, the community spread much further throughout the Four Corners region into areas that previously had not seen very many people because it wasn't that good. So the more people you have, the more you go from the good land, whatever good land there is, into ever more marginal terrain. But here's the thing. Because the rainfall is still sporadic, it might mean that one little community over here, they get enough rain, their crops succeed. And especially over generations, as they got better at agriculture, they were able to increase the yield. But just a very short distance away, another community might not have the same amount of rainfall. And so their crops, their yield might not be as good. But what this does then is it helps develop systems and networks of trade because they come to rely on each other. And so what we have is the development of a civilization that is sometimes referred to as the Chacoan civilization, after kind of the heartland of this of these people in a place called Chaco Canyon. And what you have is, it is a civilization, if you will, that is marked by larger hub communities. These are oftentimes surrounded by smaller farms, small farm communities that center around this central hub, if you will, of these larger communities that ended up becoming religious centers. They often stored excess grain. They were centers of trade, centers of culture, and politics. Because of it, you also have an increasingly stratified social system, but it works. It works, and for a while, they flourish, and population increases. They're harvesting resources. Over time, we find that they're gathering wood from further and further away. People are settling less arable land. The good land's taken up already, so you have communities springing up in places that maybe aren't quite as good. But then the inevitable happens. There's a return to drier conditions. The wetter years come to an end. Now, there had been short-term droughts earlier, and those communities, these hub communities, had responded in ways that worked, or at least appeared to work in the short term. You had rituals. You also had works projects. We would refer to them as public works projects. Think back on the Great Depression and the Civilian Conservation Corps and these kind of things. But you had building projects for those farmers who didn't have work anymore, and they built ceremonial centers, they built roads, they built great houses. You keep them occupied. But over time, the granaries start emptying. This drought lasted much, much longer. And eventually, the reserves are gone. People can't get food anymore. The old ways, the old traditions, the old structures don't work. And so what we find is that the social order ultimately ended up collapsing. But it didn't just collapse, it collapsed into anarchy and violence. And for something around three generations, this region was characterized by widespread conflict. And so there's a lot of archaeological evidence of burned out homesteads, of human remains that were found with indications of a violent death, traumatic injury to the skull, skeletons where they still have the arrowheads embedded in the skeletonized remains. A lot of the remains were left, the term that's often used is in situ. In other words, the remains were left where that person died. And what that tells us is very important, because when people die, and if they have family or friends or community still there, those remains tend to be cared for. Every culture has its own rituals and ceremonies surrounding death. But the fact that these bodies were left tells us that either their family and friends and community were dead, or they were forced to flee without being able to care for the remains. There's evidence of cannibalism. So that what we find is a fairly advanced southwestern civilization, in the face of long-term drought, descended into anarchy and violence. Now, we know that some of the people fled to the highlands, where they built these very well-known cliff castles. And the evidence suggests that during good times, they're living on top, they're farming on top. But when winter comes, they go into these. Most of these were built south-facing, so they act as solar reflectors, so they're very warm in the winter. Or when enemies threatened, they would go into these fairly inaccessible places where they were able to prepare to defend and protect themselves. Now, we also know they only lived there for about 70 years. Why? We know, once again, rainfall patterns decreased, so the dryland farming did not work anymore. And in fact, we find that there was a return to foraging methods for a while. We also know that there were below average temperatures during this era, which meant that the growing season, already impacted by a decrease in precip, was even shorter. And then last, there's also a lot of suggestion that newcomers into the area groups like the Navajo, the Ute, the Apache, who are recent arrivals in the Southwest, increasingly were competing for what resources remained. And so they left, and their descendants moved to places in New Mexico, in Arizona, where their descendants, the Puebloan peoples, still remain and still speak about some of this in their oral histories. There are lessons here, I think, that are hard to ignore. There are lessons here that even those that occurred in the distant past are still very relevant to us. The thing we have to understand is that climate change has always been a part of human history. Agriculture began something like around 10,000 years ago, with the end of the last ice age and the onset of what's referred to as the Holocene era, a fairly even and stable era in the history of the world. But even here, we see variations and gradations over time. And when you look historically at the rise of civilizations, when we look at even fairly recent history, if you look at Europe, for example, through the Middle Ages, and you talk about things like the Little Ice Age, or this extended warm period that allowed the Norse to surge out of Scandinavia and settle even in Greenland, if you look at the medieval pessimum, you find that climate change has always impacted human communities, even though we've not really talked about it. When you study European history, especially I remember my own experiences growing up, learning about the Middle Ages and so forth, you hear about wars, and you hear about kings and queens and these empires and dynasties, but you rarely look at the impact of climate change as it impacted those kind of things. And we know, actually, when we begin digging a little bit deeper, that many of those wars from the Middle Ages, many of the rise and fall of dynasties, the Black Death, all kinds of very well-known events had somewhere in there various kinds of climate-related factors that somehow impacted that society and that then played out oftentimes in very violent and destructive ways. I was just reading something about the witch crazes of the Middle Ages, where thousands upon thousands of people were accused of witchcraft, typically women, and things would happen to them like being tied up and being thrown into a body of water. If that woman drowned, that meant she was innocent, but that's okay, because at least she died pure, right? Why worry about the short time on this earth when you have the eternal life to worry about? But if she floated to the top, obviously it's witchcraft, and then she'd be taken and then hung or burned or something like this. Well, one of the things we know is that spikes in the executions of accused witches coincided with things like failed crops, famines, floods, and these kind of things. People wanted answers for why these things are happening to us, and the answer they often came up is because there's evil in our midst, and we have to take care of it. We have to cleanse our community. So, actually, in some ways, I know this might sound perverse, but recognizing this gives me hope. Researching climate change and conflict, as you might guess, can be fairly depressing stuff, fairly scary stuff. In fact, I just read this article this past autumn about how climate change scientists are in ever greater numbers dealing with issues of depression. It's not just an academic issue, but they're actually manifesting it, going to see, get help, get medication, or so forth, because it's really, to use the term that many of you use, it's really bumming them out. But actually, when you recognize this, for me, this gives me hope. Humanity has always been dealing with climate change, whether or not we realized it. And we've dealt with it more or less successfully in different times and different places, depending on many different things. In some ways, we are once again confronted with this reality. And I do, at some level, take comfort in recognizing this is nothing new. This is something we have always faced as a species. And we have thus far, knock on wood, been able to handle it. All right, so how does this connect with genocide? Science tells us we're already seeing changes, right? We've already seen changes in weather patterns and precipitation. We see drought in places, more rain, less snow, which has a significant impact, not just in terms of flooding and erosion, but also in terms of snowpack, something I'm guessing many of you in California are very aware of. Snow tends to create snowpack, which then helps replenish reservoirs and groundwater supplies in ways that rain simply cannot because it runs off. Storm systems we know are increasing in frequency and severity. And in many places around the world, coastal flooding is becoming an issue from higher storm surges, from sea level rise, and from thermal expansion. Warmer water expands. It takes up more volume. In July 1915, climate change was a topic that the Pentagon addressed, which I find actually pretty amazing. The Pentagon is not renowned for being the most progressive of institutions, but they released a report where they argued that climate change represents an urgent and a growing threat to American national security. An urgent threat, not something for down the road, not something to plan 50 years out from now, now. And part of the reason they argued this is because it represents a series of escalating and repetitive stresses that will strain weak states and exacerbates existing tensions. Climate change, I would argue, will make organized collective violence more likely. But the question is, how exactly will that work? And in order to explore that a little bit, I want to spend just a couple of minutes talking about genocide. Now, it's my understanding you had a speaker in already speaking about what is genocide, who hopefully helped you work through some of the ways in which this type of violence is defined and understood. But in brief, let me just go over through a few points that I hope to flesh out as we connect it explicitly to climate change. It, by the way, is this making sense so far? Okay. So one thing we know, genocide is usually state perpetrated, although not always. There are examples of what you might call grassroots genocides. In fact, one of the best examples of that comes from the state of California. In terms of the local militias that often sprang up in the wake of the California Gold Rush, when Native Americans were essentially hunted and exterminated by localized groups that were that then later supported by the state of California. And in fact, these militias would often be paid for their services. In other words, they were reimbursed for their ammunition, they were paid for the number of natives that they killed. But we know that tends to be more the exception, that kind of grassroots. Most genocides are perpetrated by governments. We also know that they're intentional, they're planned, they're organized, they're systematic. They don't just happen. They require a huge amount of planning and organization. They require a lot of logistics. They're often perpetrated during wars and other conflicts. If you look at the genocides of the 20th century, for example, we find that overwhelmingly they either occurred during or in the immediate aftermath of some kind of war. Wars do some very amazing things to societies. They allow a government to amass power, to restrict or remove civil rights and protections and so forth. They normalize the abnormal. They brutalize populations. They radicalize policies. They change societies in fundamental ways that allow this kind of widespread, organized extermination policies to be more easily conceived and then enacted. Wars are very closely linked with genocides. They usually rely on pre-existing prejudices and hatreds. Genocides build on the fault lines that already exist. if there are pre-existing hostilities, if there are minority groups that have historically been victimized, persecuted, marginalized, those are the kind of fault lines around which genocidal policies oftentimes revolve. Intolerance and prejudice, as we'll see, are very long-lived, and they are often resurrected during crises in order to further certain kinds of policies. Genocides target vulnerable groups. So that's where this idea of these pre-existing prejudices and hatreds comes in. If a society has minority groups that have historically been vulnerable in the past, they typically are vulnerable in the future. And all right. We know genocides are also instrumental in orientation. In other words, they're a means to an end. A perverse, horrific means, but they are nevertheless rational in orientation. People are trying to accomplish something with these policies. They think it's going to get them something, to implement some belief system, to change their society, to create a better society. It's ironic that some of the worst atrocities in human history have been perpetrated in the name of creating a more utopian society, creating a better world. Think Cambodia, think the USSR, think even Nazi Germany. We also know that that rationality is influenced by a variety of emotional elements. Human beings are not rational. We act on emotion, we act on feeling, we act on beliefs, and then we have this veneer of rationality that we often then use to try to legitimate, to justify, to rationalize what we do. But we act more from here than we do from here. And so we know that certain kinds of ways of looking at other groups, things like intolerance, prejudice, xenophobia, nationalism, racism, ideologies, in other words, belief systems, these oftentimes shape dramatically policies of governments and genocidal policies. Now, so the question of how does climate change lead to genocide is not just about the nature of genocide, but it's also about the nature of the situation. One thing we need to understand is that climate change is not a one-off event. That what we're facing are a series of changes over time. We don't know everywhere exactly the extent of the change or the speed of the change, although the most recent report from the IPCC, tells us that these changes are happening faster than we had originally anticipated. But these changes are going to continue over time. So any society can deal with a crisis. Any society has these challenges. But what happens when those challenges continue one after the other into the foreseeable future? We believe that in many states, especially weaker states, their ability to cope will be eroded. So they may well handle it initially, but over time, not as well. Their ability to deal with the changes will weaken. It requires a lot of political will, adaptive capacity, the ability to adapt, wealth and resources. Specifically, it's about resiliency. The term resiliency, if any of you are in education or you work with kids in education in different kinds of educational settings, the term resiliency is used quite a lot. In the literature, for example, on school shooters, you find that very often these school shooters were children or young adults without much resiliency. Children who are resilient are kids who are flexible. They go with the flow. They're able to handle life's little indignations or problems relatively easily. Kids who are inflexible, who whenever there's change, they can't handle it. It's like, oh, we had this planned, or you know, those kind of things. Those kind of young individuals have a tougher time. Well, in many ways, states are the same way. There are states that have a lot of, the term that's often used is resiliency. They have a lot of capacity to absorb and to adapt and change. And the resiliency revolves around a number of different kind of things. It's about the geography. Larger states generally have more resiliency because they have more terrain, more land. And so if you have an issue with drought in a small country, there's nowhere you can go. But in a big country, there are, I mean, you might be able to escape the impact of that drought. If arable land migrates because the rainfall patterns change in a large geographically diverse country, you might be able to absorb that domestically. In smaller landlocked countries, not so much. Resources and wealth. Resources are things that provide the materials you need either to directly deal with situations, or resources can be sold essentially for wealth that you can then use to pay for adaptations. More wealthy nations have the money, in other words, to pay for the kind of changes, the kinds of adaptations that they need to deal with. Leadership. What kind of leaders do you have? Are they able and willing to confront these situations? Are they able to essentially mobilize populations, mobilize further leadership in order to address them? Or are they into playing the blame game? Social, political, economic, and religious structures, the traditions, the culture, the values of a society, all of these impact the resiliency of a community. These are the things that will determine how a society decides to act or not act. We know, for example, much of Africa is considered to be at high risk because it has very low resiliency. And so, for example, North Africa is considered to be very high risk because of environmental fragility. When you look up here at North Africa, you realize a lot of this landscape is generally arid or semi-arid. It's very, a lot of it's desert. There's not a lot of depth in terms of their ability to grow crops, to support their societies. There's also widespread poverty in many of these nations as well. If you need to change your ways of doing things, if you need to start importing food, if you need to develop new infrastructures in order to deal with climate change, and you are very poor as a nation, how are you going to deal with it? How are those changes going to be paid for? We know that West Africa is also considered to be at high risk. There's endemic political corruption. Nigeria has amazing oil reserves, but it also has an incredibly corrupt society where the wealth is not being funneled back into the society itself in terms of building capacity, building industry. It's essentially going into the hands of a very few, a very small percent of the population. Pervasive ethnic conflict. Have you ever heard of Boko Haram? Right? In many of these countries, you have old antagonisms that still drive a fair amount of violence and conflict between different communities, different groups, different factions. Those will essentially prevent a nation from effectively dealing with climate change. So according to a variety of groups, North Africa and West Africa, for example, they're considered to be at high risk for not being able to deal with climate change because they have low resiliency. Now, on the other hand, Europe and North America are seen as having high resiliency, high adaptive capacity. Why? Relatively stable political systems. Although if any of you are following politics in this day and age, I'm not so sure how relevant exactly that is anymore. Wealth and resources. In other words, the money to pay for the changes that have to happen. Well-developed infrastructures, industry, technology, power, these kind of things. But even in Europe and North America, the risk will vary a lot, and it won't even in the best places be very easy. I think back here to the United States a few years ago, Hurricane Katrina, 2005. Category 3 hurricane touched shore in Louisiana, sustained winds of about 125 miles an hour as it went up into the interior of the United States. Levees break, the city of New Orleans is flooded. Within a very short period of time, state government collapsed, city government collapsed, the governor gave a shoot to kill order to the National Guard. You had a lot of violence and conflict. The evacuation of citizens, especially in the poorest communities, was mismanaged or not done at all, resulting in a lot of deaths. And this was a one-time event in the richest nation in the world. What happens when that kind of scenario, some catastrophic weather-related event, when those occur over time? Will we be ready? Now, I would argue, I do argue, there are a number of different pathways. How do you get from climate change and stresses and problems to genocide, to war, these kind of things? Well, I would argue there are a couple of different pathways here, and I want to talk about a few of them in particular. I want to talk a little bit about state failure, because I think this is a very likely scenario. I want to talk about resources, fear and prejudice, and population displacement. I don't want to talk so much simply in the interest of time and not putting you completely to sleep. Amplification of existing conflict, that really is, in places where there's ongoing wars or civil strife or these kind of things, there's a very real possibility that as these changes mount, those existing conflicts may well be exacerbated, that they just get worse. And then preemptive violence, this is something that some suggest will happen as some nations decide to take out that enemy before they take us out. That we're going to get them before they get us. But the ones I want to focus on are these others first off. So first, state failure. We know that around the world that there are already failed states and that there are other states that are weak. Places where the government is unable to assert control, to maintain law and order, to assert its authority over a bounded geographic area, over a given population. And I know in this country there is this strain of political thought of people who believe that if we can get rid of government, government's the enemy, that we'll all live together peacefully in relative harmony without the interference of this big amorphous entity. And my response to that would be to look at places like Somalia, where states have failed, and you find the rise of what's termed sometimes warlordism, and there is a huge amount of endemic violence and conflict. When a government is unable to provide for its citizens, to maintain law and order, and when it does not have perceptions of legitimacy accorded to it by its citizens, that state weakens and fails. And when that happens, you have a real problem. A great example of this comes from the DRC, and it actually connects to genocide in a very concrete way. In 1994, in neighboring Rwanda, there was a genocide that occurred. And some of the targets of that genocide, the Tutsi, streamed over the borders into refugee camps in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, seeking to flee the violence. Now, the genocide, in part, was precipitated by an ongoing civil war. The Rwandan Patriotic Front, led by Paul Kagame, had invaded. So this government, this Hutu government, is fighting the civil war. They're not doing so well, especially in the aftermath of the assassination of the president of Rwanda. This genocide that had been primed erupts. And many, many thousands of Tutsi streamed across the border into the DRC, into refugee camps. Now, as the government began losing the civil war, many of the former perpetrators themselves tried to flee the fighting and streamed over, guess where, into the DRC, into the same camps where many of their former victims had fled. They organized themselves there. They begin raiding back sometimes. It essentially created this series of events that ultimately helped destabilize the Democratic Republic of the Congo, so that from 2004 up until the present day, there have been a series of conflicts and wars and things going on there that has resulted in perhaps something like over 5 million people killed. The DRC became the sexual assault capital of the world, where entire bands of militia groups would go into communities and essentially engage in wholesale violence and sexual assault for weeks before moving on to the next community. Now, one of the reasons why this failed state has remained a failed state is because it's been in the best interest of many of the surrounding nations for it to be a failed state. Because one of the things about this portion of the world is that it's very rich in natural resources. And so what we find is that many of these neighboring countries have had a hand, essentially, in going in to promote stability, to settle things down. But really what they're doing is they're going in for resources, and they're extracting those resources. Resources have been at the heart of many conflicts. And in fact, we know that water is already a flashpoint for much violence. We don't think about it as a precious resource, but water is a very precious resource. Over 70% of the Earth's surface is covered with water, and yet over 97% of the Earth's water is unusable because it has salt in it. So in terms of drinkable water, potable water, less than 3% of Earth's water is what we can use. Yet of that, less than 1% is accessible, because much of it is locked up in underground aquifers, it's in glaciers and things like this. We're running out of water. The United Nations suggests that more than 800 people do not have access to fresh water. 800 million. The UN suggests by 2025, I think it is, about half of the world's population will live in areas of water stress, of water scarcity. We know water has already been linked with war, terrorism, and genocide. And the two examples that we could talk about are Syria and the Darfur. If we look at Syria, we can actually step back a little bit and just to give you a quick thumbnail sketch. 2010, a young Tunisian man commits suicide in his city where he had been a fruit vendor. He basically sold fruit on the street. He had been assaulted by some government officials who also took his scales. Now, he was the sole provider for his family. So he goes to the ministry to get his scales back, and then they beat him up again. And in clearly frustration, anger, rage, hopelessness, he goes on the street out in front of that ministry, poured fuel over himself, and set himself on fire. This young man, his name, I believe, was Mohamed Bouazizi, and he sparked what we now refer to as the Arab Spring, a series of protests, demonstrations, revolts that ended up overthrowing a number of governments in the Middle East, fundamentally changing the political map of North Africa and the Middle East. It hit here in Syria in 2011 with a series of protests and marches that quickly degenerated into violence as the government responded with extreme force. That sparked the development of a series of conflicts that escalated into civil war, that helped promote the rise of ISIS. If any of you follow the news, these are big events that the United States is very much concerned with and involved with. But what we often don't recognize is that underneath this is the issue of water. From 2006 to 2011, Syria was subject to a very deep drought. During that time period, I believe wheat production dropped something like 50%. Barley, another staple crop, dropped something like 70%. The livestock dropped from something like 21 million to 15 million. And millions of young Syrians lost their livelihood. The UN's estimate says something like 1.5 million Syrians were displaced because of this drought. Think about it. Herders, small farmers, you can't feed your family anymore. Your farm has failed. And you head to the cities. You go to the cities looking for work, looking for opportunity, looking to support your family. And so when the civil war, or when these protests began, there was a large supply of angry, unemployed young people, especially young men, who were ripe for change. Because they saw that the policies that the Syrian state had pursued in the midst of this drought did not help them at all. And they were the ones who were most active in terms of the opposition movement. And the violence that erupted in the aftermath. We don't think about it that way. When we talk about ISIS and terrorism and this existential threat to the United States, we don't think about water as being one of the underlying factors that help make that situation possible. Or we can look at the Darfur. The Darfur is another example where water played an important role, although we often don't recognize it. The Darfur is a region in the country of Sudan. And in 2003, you had a number of young men from some of the tribes in the Darfur formed a couple of different groups and attacked some government installations. Now the thing is, historically, the tribes in the Darfur have been seen as second-class citizens. They felt politically, socially, and economically marginalized. And these young guys, they're going to change things. Now, what they didn't anticipate was that the government in Khartoum would react by forming militias, referred to often as the Janjaweed, attacking the villages, engaging in a lot of violence that continues to this day, although in much less overt form. In fact, what we know is that the widespread destruction and burning of villages and so forth, these things aren't happening hardly at all anymore. Instead, you have a number of scholars of the genocide in Darfur. They've developed this new concept in some ways that they refer to as genocide by attrition, where essentially you have many, many thousands of people who've been displaced, who are living in these IDP camps, who are prevented essentially from returning to their homes, from getting enough food and supplies, genocide by attrition. Now, the reason that is oftentimes used to explain this genocide is that the development of these two revolutionary groups and that the government in Khartoum was always much more Arabic culturally and religiously, whereas the tribes in the Darfur were much more much less Islamic and much more traditional in terms of religion, culture, and so forth. It's often portrayed as race, although that's not a correct way to view this. But what we don't understand is actually a lot of this has to do with water. So that the Sahara has increasingly been encroaching on the Sudan. Now, in the north, the northern Darfurian tribes tend to be semi-nomadic with livestock, cultures that revolve around moving their herds of cattle. But the grasslands are gone, the water is gone, and increasingly, they have no place for their herds. The tribes in the south of Darfur, those who've been most targeted in the violence, they tend to be much more agricultural in orientation. They've got farms. Now, violence broke out here in the 1980s between some of these tribes, but it ended after a series of negotiations. But when, in 2003, this violence erupted again, these Janjaweed militia were largely recruited from these tribes in the north to attack the tribes in the south, and thereby acquiring land for their livestock. In many ways, there are all kinds of factors at work here, but underneath it all, what is it about? It's about resources. And increasingly, we are seeing water as a flashpoint for violence. What happens when you have a number of nations depending on a river for agriculture, for potable water, and someone upstream of you decides they're going to dam it off so that they have that water for power and for their agriculture, for irrigation and so forth? We're seeing that happen in certain places in Central Asia, in the Middle East, other places as well. Water, I would argue, will be one of the most potent flashpoints. Okay. So, part of the pathways, I think, is going to revolve around our attitudes. We know when times are tough, people change in terms of their attitudes. There's a lot of criminological literature that looks at people's support for punitive policies, their views towards minority groups, and that these change during tough times. In fact, going all the way back to the work of Irvin Staub and others, one of the precursors to genocide are something that's often referred to as tough times, tough economic, social, political situations. People, when they're scared, they react in fairly predictable ways. Communities react in very predictable kinds of ways. We know that societies often revert to nationalistic kinds of ideas, to xenophobic ideas. There's a lot more support for processes and policies. You're familiar with the term othering? That other populations, right, that portray that group as the enemy, as different, as dangerous, and so forth and so on. And we know that political leaders may well find it very easy to scapegoat specific groups for the contemporary issues and problems that they're facing there. Now, scapegoating as a practice goes back way into early history, where communities would symbolically place all of their sins upon a person or a scapegoat. And then that animal or that person would be driven out of the community, or in many cases killed, so that that community could then start the new year clean, without sin, and no risk of incurring the wrath of the gods. In the modern era, scapegoating works in a couple of different ways. One, it's a way to divert attention away from failed policies. You've tried something, it didn't work, people aren't very happy, blame that group. It's also a tool that provides answers that resonate, that make sense. In 2008, the economy tanked, right? How many of you understood exactly why? One, two, three, I don't, four. I mean, junk bonds, bad loans, I don't get it. But when someone tells me it's those fat cat bankers on Wall Street, I get that, right? It gives an answer that I can understand. It gives an answer that resonates with certain prejudices or certain attitudes I might have. That's how scapegoating works. And we know this historically. The classic example of scapegoating would be Hitler and the rise of the Nazis. Hitler and the Nazis did not invent anti-Semitism. Anti-Semitic ideas had been widespread in Europe a long time, facilitated and fueled by religious leaders all the way back to the beginnings of Christianity. But Hitler and the Nazis, what they were able to do was offer a two-pronged approach in their appeal to German voters. One, we're going to restore Germany to a place of pride. We're going to make Germany great again. I know some very scary resonances here today. And we also know who to blame. So that, why did we lose the war? Our troops were still in the field. The front didn't collapse. We were stabbed in the back, the famous Dolchstoßlegende. Why did the economy tank during the Great Depression? Why did you lose all your life savings? All of Germany's ills, all of the social problems were laid at the door of a group that had historically been the recipients of a lot of stereotypes and prejudices. So that even if you were not an active anti-Semite yourself, you were familiar with the tropes. You knew those images. You knew those messages. It built on pre-existing schisms and then made them into huge, huge chasms that separated us from them. Prejudice has a very long lifespan. It makes me think about, in Arizona, forest fires are a big issue. We had a fire last year that hit Oak Creek Canyon just south of town, and it was like an arrow pointed straight at Flagstaff. And it was roaring up the canyon before they were finally able to stop. In fact, they evacuated some of the outlying neighborhoods in Flagstaff. And one of the things, talking with some people I know who work on those crews fighting those fires, is that fire is hard to eradicate in the Southwest because you can quench it, you can stop the flames, but what often happens is that it retreats underground. It's under the surface where it just smolders. And what happens is you think it's licked, you think it's gone, you're safe, and given the right circumstances, the right wind conditions and humidity, those embers, that little thing underground that's just kind of working away can spring back into flame again. And before you know it, you've got another wildfire. And that's how prejudice works in my mind. That we think, you know, we make all this progress against intolerance and these kind of stereotypes and so forth. And we think we've got it, you know, we can let our guard down. But give the right circumstances and the right people willing to exploit those prejudices, and those can be fanned back up again. There's no inoculation, there's no immunity that you can give where it's not a risk. Population dislocation. Am I depressing you enough yet? But I feel like that in that old, you know, wait, there's more. Population dislocation. This is going to be a huge issue. During the 1990s, they believed around 25 million, this is the UN High Commissioner for Refugees, suggested there were around 25 million displaced due to droughts, disasters, environmental degradation. 25 million people worldwide. Is that a lot? Yeah. By 2050, predictions suggest that there will be nearly 200 million people, while one study suggests that number may be closer to 700 million. Think about that, 700 million people on the move. I was just in Berlin a couple of weeks ago, and it was interesting to me that the number one issue that Germany seemed to be dealing with, from the people I met, from some of the protests I saw on the streets, from the news, was the issue of immigration. So those of you who follow the news may know this, but this past year, Europe has seen a huge influx of refugees coming from North Africa, a lot from Syria, people fleeing the violence, but also people coming from further afield, places such as India, Bangladesh, and others. People fleeing conflict, people also fleeing endemic poverty and so forth. And Europe has really been struggling to cope with this influx. Germany has accepted something like 1 million new refugees, and in a country of something like, I think it's like 80 million, this is huge. And Germany has very progressive values around these kinds of issues, but it's a real strain. And what we've seen in Germany has been a rise in reactions against immigrants. So that, for example, in New Year's, some of you may have heard of this, there were a series of assaults, sexual assaults against German women at celebrations. And the news has made has emphasized, shall I say, the fact that many of the participants were young men, and the point that's often made is that these young men, most of them were refugees. Now, in terms of some of the investigations I've seen, actually only a small number were truly refugees. But here's the point. This builds upon certain ideas, certain deep-seated prejudices, perhaps, and the exception is used to prove the rule why we can't have these refugees coming in anymore. In Sweden, another progressive state that has accepted a large number of refugees, there have been essentially gangs of nativists who have gone on attacks in refugee communities, assaulting everyone they come across. You ever heard of Kristallnacht? Shades of that. Europe is already straining. This was every news show, every talk show, and even on the streets, I would see marches and people raising this issue. What's it going to be like 5 years from now, 10 years from now, when those numbers double, triple, or get even greater? Has it been an issue here in the States as well? Have there been governors suggesting we're not going to accept refugees, right? And this is still in the abstract. Population dislocation, as people live in states that are failed, that descend into violence, as people live in areas where the arable land is gone, they're going to want to leave to go to other places where they have a hope of supporting themselves, of a future, of whatever it is they need. How will those states deal with the influx of refugees, especially given that there may then be religious differences, cultural differences, racial, ethnic, and so forth and so on? Again, these divides that are oftentimes the fault lines around which violence is played out. One area I would suggest that is particularly at risk is Bangladesh. I think the bulk of the world's population lives either along coastlines or within 50 miles of coastlines. Most vulnerable are those living in river deltas, because river deltas are essentially low-level sediments that are particularly at risk for flooding, from storm surges, from sea level rise, these kind of things. One country that's particularly at risk is this country, which is essentially river sediment from three rivers that come out into the Bay of Bengal. Bangladesh is one of the most densely populated nations in the world. It's also one of the poorest nations in the world. It is also one of the most low-lying nations in the world. Already, if you look at the history of Bangladesh, during the 1990s, during the 1980s, there have been storms coming off of the bay that have flooded massive sections of the countries, has displaced, in some cases, millions of people. And those were just temporary inundations. What happens when large sections of Bangladesh go underwater? Oop, shoot, sorry. Where are those people going to go? Some of them will stay in Bangladesh in the higher hinterlands, but estimates suggest that millions of people will be forced to flee and become environmental refugees, with many of them looking for shelter in neighboring India. Now, if any of you know the history of India, you know that the formation of Pakistan and East Pakistan, was it? What were the 1970s? Anyone trying to remember dates? I'm not very good at dates. But it was accompanied by a lot of violence. There are historic antagonisms here, and we still see it play out sometimes. India sees riots between Hindu and Muslim, between Sikh and Hindu, and all kinds of permutations all the time. Not all the time, but periodically enough so that it is something that there's a great deal that's been written about it. So what happens when you suddenly have millions of refugees living in communities, needing resources, needing food, needing water, needing shelter, and these communities in India are already struggling to meet the demands of their own citizens? We know that, for example, coastal communities in India are going to be dramatically impacted because of the infusion of salt water into their underground aquifers and the rivers. We know that fisheries are expected to leave, so that those fishing communities aren't going to be able to get enough fish to support themselves anymore. A lot of India is agricultural based, and yet the Indian subcontinent is expected to receive prolonged drought. The rivers that are largely glacial melt, those flows are going to decrease dramatically. So India is going to be struggling. It's got challenges. And then you have a large number of people coming in as outsiders from a different religious background, different cultural traditions. India has already started constructing a wall. They're anticipating they're going to build a wall. Does this sound familiar? They're going to build a wall that's going to protect the border with Bangladesh. These are the fault lines. Now, borders, these places are particularly at risk. Frontier regions. We know borders have oftentimes played a crucial role in genocide. Whether it's Bosnia, the Krajina, Kosovo, whether Eastern Europe during the Second World War and the Holocaust, border regions are very dangerous places because a lot of times they situate states, diverse populations, and resources in very close proximity to each other. And those, during times of stress and change, can result in a lot of conflict, especially when there are competing claims for territory and resources. We think of borders as being static, as not changing. These borders are eternal. But the reality is, borders have changed over time quite a lot, which means you have now what we used to have. We remember when we had that. We want it back. There's a reason why this portion of Europe, Eastern Europe, has been referred to by people such as Timothy Snyder as the Bloodlands. Because it's a place where empires and dynasties and different nation states have competed for resources and have worked to change the boundaries over time. Where populations remember when we belong to that nation. These are not eternal boundaries. What happens when agricultural land moves across these borders? So that you are interested in making sure you've got enough to feed your population and the best land, because of the change in precipitation, is right up there across that border in a land that we used to claim as our own. There are risks there. National histories are oftentimes filled with images of territorial loss, injustice, historic times of greatness, when this was all ours. And because they tend to be diverse, because they're on the periphery where you have many different nationalities and populations living close together, there are oftentimes places where these old ideas can be resurrected. The best example, I would argue, today is here. Think about Russia and the violence it has engendered in the eastern portion of the Ukraine that continues to this day, where Russia believes that the Ukraine is in their sphere of interest. You have a lot of Russian-speaking Ukrainians whose affiliation, whose identity is closer to Moscow than it is to Kiev. And essentially what you have is the annexation of the Crimea and the eastern industrial heart of Ukraine. Territorial ambitions are playing out today. But wait, there's more. If you look at the genocide in Bosnia that came about after the dissolution of the state of Yugoslavia, it's no accident that it occurred in Bosnia-Herzegovina. Croatia, Slovenia, those were largely homogeneous areas. Croatia was largely Croat. Slovenia was largely Slovenian. But here in Bosnia, you had a real patchwork of different groups. It was often, and historically, it was considered a frontier region. And so you had Serb living with Bosnian Muslim, living with Croatians, and so forth. And so when Bosnia-Herzegovina declared independence from the rump Yugoslavia, it was immediately contested by Bosnian Serbs who were secretly funded and trained and armed by Serbia and declared a Republika Srpska. In justifying it, they referred back to the Battle of Kosovopolje, the Field of Blackbirds, back in 1389 when the Serbs had been defeated by the Ottomans. And we need to reclaim our lost greatness. We've been previously victimized. And politicians such as Slobodan Milosevic were able to exploit those ideas and created a genocide in Europe in the 1990s. Never again was the slogan after the Holocaust, and unfortunately, we did see it again in Europe in the 1990s. Now, it's not all doom and gloom. We have lots of antidepressants that can help. Seriously, we need to understand that what I'm doing here is an exercise in the worst case scenario. Places where states fail and descend into violence, thus further decreasing the resources and leading to less ability to meet the needs of citizens, thus increasing the, right? This whole cycle, as one example. But these are what-if scenarios. We don't live in a world of certainties, we live in a world of probabilities. And I think there are some very powerful countervailing forces. I would argue, for example, international law has come a very long way. When I first started doing this kind of work, international law was still very, very patchwork and ineffective. Now it's a little less ineffective and not quite as patchwork, and actually has had some success. We know, for example, the tools of transitional justice mechanisms have come a very long way and have helped a large number of states transition from conflict into post-conflict stability, democracy, and so forth. We have a long way to go, but we've come a long way. We have actually put on trial people who did certain things as sitting heads of state, legitimate heads of state. Sovereign immunity in the modern era has been seriously weakened. It's not perfect. Omar al-Bashir just took a visit to Indonesia, even though he's under indictment by the International Criminal Court, and speaks to the inability currently to completely enforce. But the fact that Slobodan Milosevic was in The Hague for what he did as the leader of the rump Yugoslavia, that says something. International law has come a long way and it continues to be developed. Technology. Social media. These are powerful tools. Now, it's like anything else. These tools can be used for good or for evil. One of the things, for example, that if you look at the rise of ISIS and its ability to recruit Americans, Western Europeans, to its cause, a big part of the reason is because it has used social media very effectively. But we also know that social media has been used for all kinds of wonderful causes in some very positive, powerful ways, promoting certain positive kinds of movements, helping affect political and social change. There isn't a lot anymore that can happen in absolute secrecy and silence. Young people. People such as many of the students in this room today. When I teach my courses and I look at my students, as long as I'm not in the middle of grading, which tends to color my judgment, but when I look at the passion, the activism, the commitment to positive social change, it gives me hope. When I look at some of the things that are happening in Western Europe around illegal immigration, I get worried. But then I see many young people organizing counter-protests or making sure that they're welcoming refugees into their communities and doing whatever they can to help them make a new start. There's a lot of hope there. Humanity has always had to deal with climate-related changes. That's not new. The question is, how are we going to be dealing with the changes that we are increasingly facing here in the United States and around the world? And I would add, I guess part of the answer lies in what young people choose to do about it. Does that make sense? It's like that Star Wars line, "You are our last best hope." But seriously, the power to change the world lies in the hands of young people all around the world. And when I look at some of the things that are happening, not everything, but some of the things that are happening, I do find that there is reason to hope. With technology, impacting climate change, technology spreading messages, mobilizing populations, with the growing power of international law, with enough committed people willing to affect change, willing to hold leaders accountable, willing to do the kind of things that societies will need to do to make sure that they retain the adaptive capacity, some of these kinds of risks can be averted or minimized. Oh my gosh. I think I went long. Anyway, I hope it's not been too depressing. I hope there have been some ideas there for you to think about, and thank you. So I am yours for however long we still have to answer whatever questions. I'll go ahead and repeat the question so that everyone can hear it, and then I will do my best to answer. Are there any questions? Down here. Have I worked Game of Thrones in? I haven't worked Game of Thrones in, although I have to say, when I was in Berlin on this last trip, I couldn't sleep at night. And right now, the big hit in Germany is Game of Thrones dubbed, which, if you haven't seen, it is an experience. Winter kommt, you know. I have to say, popular media, movies and so forth, I think actually they do sometimes have a lot to teach us and show us. Sometimes it's about where we've been, sometimes it's about where we're going. Essentially, they're about the human story and how communities act and react and so forth. Now, I have never thought about, I mean, it really is. Game of Thrones is a TV series about climate change. Although with ice walkers and with all kinds of, you know, War of the Roses politics thrown in. I'm not sure.
I was actually in an ISA panel last year where this was brought up. Okay.
Accessible, perhaps. Yeah. Yeah. Ah, good point. I'll have to rethink.
Wow.
Interesting. All right. Yes.
I've got a question. Coming back to the topic of refugees, I don't want to put a crisis as one of the topics, but in Europe, there's the European Union, and we have the ones that formerly forbid countries to just build up. Just as Hungary and other states did, and these countries can't be enforced, and there is already an institution. Like, seeing this whole issue globally, there's not such an institution as the European Union that could actually enforce international laws. So how could that be possibly done? Is the future still able to be safe by means of the democratic?
Well, I do. I was not facetious when I suggested that these things aren't written in stone. We haven't played these things out yet. We haven't lived them. Now, there are real risks and pressures. We know, for example, a number of Western European nations have accepted a fair number of immigrants into their communities, but there has been backlash. how those nations deal with a backlash will be very telling. We know, for example, Denmark, their parliament just passed a law that essentially, what is it? Not fines is the right word, but where they basically, any refugee that comes in with more than a certain amount of money, they're going to take it. And it's viewed as a way to disincentivize refugees going to Denmark. Now, in response, many people in Denmark have organized protests and demonstration against that new legislation. You're right, there is no international police that can enforce all of these kind of laws, even within the EU. And that is one of the biggest weaknesses of international law, is that the mechanisms to enforce them are still relatively weak. But they're not non-existent. And there are all kinds of pressures that have been brought to bear. Pressures, for example, that made the new president of Serbia turn in Slobodan Milosevic to the Hague. Yeah. One more and then I'll move on.
In this scenario, I just think that changes are happening super fast.
Right. And so the question is about, you know, that you're noticing that, for example, these changes are happening very quickly, and that's challenging the ability of these nations to deal with these. That's the real key. How fast will these changes happen? Slow change, easy to deal with. You have time, right? But the problem is that these changes are happening faster than we initially thought they would. And they are mounting. They're more serious than we thought they would. The predictions in terms of sea level rise, in terms of temperatures, all of these things are going out the window. They were too conservative. Now, in terms of, are those kind of right-wing politicians, are they going to be able to influence policy? That's the real question. I would suggest in countries like Germany and Sweden and so forth, it's not very likely that they'll be able to take power or that they'll be able to dramatically influence policy around refugees. In places like Greece, Italy, Spain, Hungary, I think they have more ability to gain power and dictate the ways in which their nations address refugees. But I think we are, you know, we're talking about refugees here in the United States a lot and in Europe a lot. And we're talking about this wave as if it is a wave. And the reality is, I think that we're seeing the beginnings of a much larger process over time. And how we choose to deal with it now, I think will shape how we choose to deal with it down the road. Yeah, you had your hand up. So is the UN able to do anything about this? There's no easy answer to that. In some ways, it really depends. In terms of preventing or intervening outright in mass human rights violations, the UN track record is not very good. For example, if any of you are familiar with the history of the Rwanda genocide, you know that the UN had a peacekeeping force in Rwanda prior to the beginnings of the violence. And in fact, their commanding officer, a Canadian by the name of Romeo Dallaire, found out that the Hutu extremist groups were collecting hit lists of targets. And they were actually also putting together stockpiles of weapons. He communicated this to his boss at the UN. It was then Kofi Annan, who later went on to become Secretary General of the United Nations. And was told, don't do anything, this is beyond our mandate. And then when the violence erupted, most of the UN peacekeepers, especially because some of them were captured, tortured, and killed, the UN peacekeepers were brought home, largely. Many Western nations sent in troops not to prevent the violence, but to extract their own citizens. And there are scenes there where Tutsis, in fear for their lives, and understanding that these troops are not going to rescue them, asked the troops to kill them because they thought it would be a quicker, cleaner death than what they were going to receive at the hands of the Hutu mobs. The UN has not been very effective at all in preventing genocide or in intervening genocide. On the other hand, the UN does a huge amount of good all around the world with all kinds of humanitarian aid and assistance. They substantively have changed the quality of life in nations, and continue to do so in nations all around the world. But typically, those are not as, you know, well known or as well publicized as these big military interventions and so forth. The largest UN intervention to date that's ongoing is still in the DRC. The most people, the most resources, and it has not been able to essentially recover this failed state. Keep in mind that we often blame the UN, but the UN really, in many ways, is only a reflection of the member states, right? It is not the UN that we should be looking to. It is these nations that make up the United Nations that are able to shape what the UN and the international community does or is willing to do. And there is a great deal of room for improvement there, I would argue. Absolutely. Yes?
I just want to go back to the beginning of the lecture when you talked about the Native Americans in the cave canyon type things.
The Chacoan civilization?
Yeah, and specifically cannibalism. Like, why did they refer to that, and what was the effect that it had on future generations?
Well, that's actually a pretty controversial issue. But the evidence taken from refuse dumps from this era, right, and from, I forget what the term is, but it is essentially fossilized human waste. You know what I'm talking about. There's pretty clear evidence that resources were so bad that there was so much fighting and violence and a lack of food supplies that one of the things that was happening in some places at some times was that they were essentially eating the remains of some of their victims. Yeah. Yes?
A lot of individuals have asked about basically supranational issues in terms of international law, the sovereignty of member states, you know, being given. Given that the United States being, you know, a permanent five member in the Security Council, what do you see in the Americas to be able to pressure the United States to have more say and more pressure to, you know, put forth that this is a threat and that something needs to be done about climate change and these issues? Is there anything specifically within our region or sphere of influence, if you will, that would pressure us to do that?
So in some ways, what role will the United States play? That's the big question. In fact, we're in part deciding that today. Today isn't today the second Super Tuesday, right? The United States does have a role to play, and we have a huge amount of influence around the world. But how we choose to exercise that is anybody's guess. In some ways, we have not been the best at promoting change around climate change issues because we have members of our government who continue to deny that it's actually happening and foster doubt, foster dissension in order to not do anything. On the other hand, there are a lot of people in this country and actually around the world working to educate, working to raise awareness, and to make us and other places realize that it is happening and that we need to confront it sooner or later. And the sooner we confront it, the better we're able to ameliorate it. Now, the real risk, I would argue, the real risk we face here in the United States that I would suggest is also a possibility and maybe even a probability in other places around the world, is a fortress mentality taking hold. Kind of a new American or a new isolationism where you have the wealthier nations essentially retreat from the world, wall off their borders as best they can, maybe not just literally, but also figuratively, and hunker down to protect what resources we still have. And that risk of, kind of a new era of isolationism, I think is very real. Resource-rich nations are going to sit down and try to defend with moats and walls and whatever technology and drones what they have, and the rest of the world can look out after themselves. I don't know if that's really viable. And we have to understand that what's happening in places all around the world impacts us in very direct ways and very indirect ways as well. We cannot wall ourselves off. It is one globe, and we're on it with everyone else. So the question is, do I have any suggestions for organizing anti-genocide kinds of practices or so forth? What can you do? This is a question I get a lot of times around genocide, and it's very easy. You watch these kinds of shows or these presentations and you get outraged, right? And it's horrific, the kinds of things that occur. There's no one answer to that. I would say there are organizations around climate change, education, and awareness. There are organizations around more sustainable practices in terms of living by example and minimizing your carbon footprint, those kind of things. There are organizations that work to promote human rights and intervene in genocides. There are organizations here in the United States and international organizations. And I would encourage you to look into those. Nowadays, all you need to do is get on a computer and type in a search and so forth. But I would also argue it's something even more basic than that in addition. It's good to get involved globally. It's good to get involved with organizations and to support organizations doing good work. But I would also argue it starts here in your own communities. Because one of the things, the older I get, the more I realize how things are interconnected. Everything's connected. It was always surprising to me when I would go into schools and do work on anti-bullying and I would listen to what these young individuals were saying, why they were doing what they were doing. And in many ways, their justifications, their rationales, their viewing of their victims paralleled in some very disturbing ways what I came across in genocide. Human beings are the same. And even though the context may be different, the processes we engage in to other people, to distance ourselves from them, to dehumanize them, to maintain our positive view of ourselves is the same. And so what I would suggest is, you don't have genocide occurring here in Rohnert Park, but certainly do we look at how in our own communities we stereotype others? How we treat people who are different from us? Do we stigmatize? Do we stereotype? Do we allow injustice to occur? Because these are part and parcel of the same kinds of things, albeit not to that extreme level. I think we as a nation are wrestling with this right today. Absolutely. The whole anti-Trump movement that has just started taking place, in large part has been spurred because of the statements of this potential Republican nominee for the presidency, because he has made statements that many people take very strong issue with as being, outrageous, as fostering intolerance and prejudice and hatred. So I would argue we need to look in our own lives how we treat people who are different from us, how we deal with the other in our communities. That's where it starts. What is that old saying? Maybe this goes back a little bit too far to the 1970s or so forth. Think globally, act locally, right? So get involved with these organizations, and there is a lot of them out there, even old, long-standing ones like Human Rights Watch, Amnesty International, anti-genocide organizations, and so forth. But it's also about how in our own communities we allow injustice and intolerance to survive, and what we do about that. Yeah. Yes. So the question was, given that we are facing an era in which we may well see many more refugees and internally displaced populations, is it better to help them make a transition in a new place, or is it better to help develop technologies and practices that allow them to sustain life where they are? And the answer is both. The question you ask is, how do you sell this accepting populations of people who are different into your own communities? The thing about violence, and the thing about genocide in particular, is that it exploits something that Freud referred to as the narcissism of minor difference. You take small things that seem different, and then you create a mountain out of them. Small distinctions that you suddenly use to show how worse they are, how different they are, how less than they are. The thing that we need to remember is that these people. They're like us. And if you look at the literature on rescuers during the Holocaust, so for example, there was this famous village in the south of France, Le Chambon, that was responsible for the rescue of many thousands of strangers. People who literally would show up at the doors of total strangers asking for help. Now keep in mind, when you help these people you didn't know, you were putting your own life at risk, the lives of your family at risk as well. I mean, this is real. But there were a lot of reasons why this village engaged in such widespread acts of rescue. But a big part of it, when people interviewed members of these communities, it came down very often to the idea that we could not see them as anything else except people like us. The thing is, for all of the differences that we have, the diversity of belief and appearance and culture and traditions, at the end of the day, we're all human beings on this one little planet. And the thing we need to remember is that these are people like us. And the more we acknowledge our common humanity, the better able we will be able to offer whatever assistance we can. And that's the key, whether or not we're able to do that. Whether we have the leadership and the will to recognize our common humanity in preservation of our fellow human beings. That, I think that's where the answer lies.